respecting Allah is respecting our fellow human beings, our fellow Muslims, our fellow creation. Anytime we have a connection with somebody or something else, the way we treat that is a reflection of our taqwa with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we can't separate between the two. We can't be people who only focus on their relationship with their Lord and somehow think that relationships with other people, other organizations, other communities is not included in that. And so this is why we see in the Quran that it's mentioned multiple times that Allah orders us to be as one. And He says, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْدِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. Hold fast, all of you, together with the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hold fast, all of you, together with the rope of Allah. What is this rope of Allah? What is the rope of Allah? Just like if a person falls off of a ship and he starts grabbing for something to hang on to, and somebody throws him a life jacket or a life vest or a tube or a rope, think of the way that he would grab onto that rope. And then if he doesn't or she doesn't grab onto that rope, they would drown. In the same way, we can drown in this life. And Allah has thrown us a rope. He has given us a rope. But He is reminding us that that rope, it's not just for each one of us. He didn't say, hold fast to the rope of Allah as an individual. If we look at the way things are mentioned in the Quran, we really have to reflect. Because we know, we have firm belief that this is the book of Allah. This is the revelation of Allah. It's not the speech of human beings. And so when we look at His book and how He is speaking to us, let's analyze each point. So if I said to you, hold fast to the rope of Allah, you could think, well, that's an order for me as an individual to hold fast to the rope. Or it could be a group of people. Well, then in Arabic, the verb is differentiated between one person or multiple people. So he says, وَاعْتَصِمُوا. All of you, it's a plural, all of you hold fast to the book of Allah. But then somebody might say, well, it's the plural, and so maybe a group of us could hold fast to the rope of Allah, hang on to the rope of Allah. But then Allah emphasizes what He's saying. He's not talking to one person. We've established that. He's saying as a group, hold on to the rope of Allah. But just to make sure that there's no divisiveness within the groups, He says, جَمِيعًا وَاعْتَصِمُوا. Hold fast. بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ. By the rope of Allah. جَمِيعًا. All of you. وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. And don't split up. Don't split up. This one ayah has a solution for all of our problems. This one ayah has a solution for the Muslim world's problems. It has a solution for humankind's problems. That if we sincerely come together as one, not to say that we're going to agree with one another and that we're going to put aside our differences. We can have differences. But as in another ayah where Allah is commanding us as believers to hold fast together, He says, وَلَا تَنَازَعُوا. Obey Allah and His Messenger. So we are all doing that. We obey Allah and we obey His Messenger. وَلَا تَنَازَعُوا. But don't dispute amongst yourselves. You can have difference. But don't dispute and allow those disputes to cause divisions amongst you. وَتَذْهَبَ رِيحُكُمْ. And then your power, your strength will go away. It will go away if we split up. Allah recognizes that we have differences. We all have differences. But He reminds us that in these differences is a way for us to come together. إِنَّا جَعَلَنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلًا. We have made you peoples and nations. Nations and tribes. Allah says that He's reminding us He's the one who made those differences. Cultural differences. Racial differences. We have different skin colors. We have different languages. We have different cultures and religions. لِتَعَارَفُ. So that you can not know. Allah didn't say لِتَعْرِفُ. So that you may know. لِتَعَارَفُ. So that you can come to know one another. That you can come to know one another. With your differences, you come and you know that one another, and then what's the end result of that dialogue that we have as communities, as families, as tribes, as nations? Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. The most noble amongst you is the one with the most taqwa. So that's the essential core teaching. All of our differences, language differences, cultural differences, everything, the most noble of us is the one with the most taqwa. But the only way we can know that is by looking at our differences and recognizing our differences. But when it comes time to come together, we all have to come together. As an example, when devastation hits humanity or hits a community, if we did not all come together as human beings, as Muslims, as believers, if we didn't come together, what would be the result? We have an example right here in the masjid or outside the prayer area where there's a blood drive going on today. And I encourage you to go over there and see if you can donate. But look at that. What connects us to each other as human beings? We are the children of Adam. In this ayah that the Messenger of Allah used to begin his khutbas with, he says, have taqwa of Allah with your arham, with your connections. And what connects us more than our blood? As human beings, we all share the same blood. Going back to Adam, we believe that we all came from Adam. We don't believe that we came from apes. Part of our belief. We believe we came from Adam, alayhi salam. Allah made us different than other creatures. And He honored us. And our father was Adam. So while others may come with their proofs of here's this proof or here's that proof, I mean, even those things, there's no final answer. At first they say human beings are 200,000 years old. And then, oh, we found somebody in Morocco, a human Homo sapiens skeleton, 300,000 years old. And oh, we found human-like teeth, 10 million years old. So they still haven't even figured out what's buried in our earth below us that has our human history. But we have our history in our book, in the Quran, that says we came from Adam. And so when we look at each other as human beings, we're reminded of that. And when we come together to donate, that's a reminder. That's how we can show our taqwa, to come together, to hold on to the rope of Allah. But what is this rope? What is the rope of Allah that He is calling us to hold fast to, together as one? It's the Quran, the book of Allah. Hold fast together by the book of Allah. Use that as your guiding factor. The other ayah that I mentioned, don't dispute amongst yourselves, it begins by saying, obey Allah and His Messenger. That's the first step in making sure that our differences, the differences of our culture, of our understanding, even in our understanding of the Quran, or understanding of the deen, that doesn't cause us to split up into groups. It goes back to obeying Allah and His Messenger. Well, how can we obey Allah and His Messenger unless we go back to the Quran? We begin with the Quran. We go back to the Quran to find out that if you have a dispute amongst yourself, turn it over to Allah and His Messenger. If you have a dispute, turn it over to Allah and His Messenger to find that out. So we see these themes of being together as one. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam telling us that yadullahi ma'al jama'ah, that the assistance of Allah is with the congregation. The Arabic says yad, but we don't believe in anthropomorphic interpretations. We don't give Allah a body, like some believe that He has a body and that occupies a space. We reject that as Muslims. So when we see this hadith that says yadullahi ma'al jama'ah, the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with Allah. Yadullahi fawqa aydihim, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was with those believers when they gave the bay'ah, the allegiance to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But Allah, the Messenger of Allah, is reminding us that if we are seeking assistance, it's being with the group. It's being with the group. So when we face a disaster, or when we face oppression, as we're facing now with this wave and the onslaught of Islamophobia, not only here in these United States, but around the world. Our Muslim brothers and sisters in India are being attacked by Islamophobes just for the suspicion of having beef or transporting cows for the purpose of beef. There's now people that have been lynched. We know these stories. For the suspicion of that. And what is fueling that? That's hate against the Muslims. Hate against this group of people and some of the things that they hold. Whereas one of the Muslims mentioned, he said, I don't go out and to the Christians or the Hindus or the Buddhists who drink alcohol. We're not going around lynching those just because our faith prohibits that. لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينَ To you, your way, and to me, my way. My faith prohibits alcohol. And so I won't use it, but I'm not going to go out and take the law into my own hands. And if so, if my faith allows me to eat beef, then you don't have the right to vigilante police what I'm doing. So we're seeing this happening around this world, and it's happening more and more. There's an institution here in the Bay Area that has brought some of the heads of this movement of Islamophobia that attack Muslims and don't have a complete understanding of Islam. And there's a response that's happening, not only from the Muslim community, but also from the greater community. People of other faiths, maybe even people who don't have faith, but they see injustice. They see that something is wrong. They see that this group of people are being attacked for nothing else other than that they say, Rabbi Allah. That's it. That's what they're attacking us. Because we say, my Lord is Allah. And this is not something that's new to us. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq criticized the Quraysh when they would oppress the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, are you oppressing him only because he says, my Lord is Allah, Rabbi Allah? And this is the same thing that was stated to the people, to Fir'aun, when he was oppressing the believers. And they said, would you kill a man because he said, Rabbi Allah, just because he said, my Lord is Allah? So this theme of oppression because of faith is recurrent throughout history. When we read any of those stories, we see that. We see the oppression of Bani Israel. We see the oppression of the Quraysh. We see the oppression to the Ashab al-Ukhdud, the people of the fire that were thrown in there only because they said their Lord is Allah. So this is happening. It's a part of the test that's sent to the believer. But one of the ways that we can get assistance from Allah is by coming together as one, as a Muslim community, and then as a human community, to reject this oppression of people based on faith. So one of the things that we have to do, brothers and sisters, as communities, is we have to come together as communities. Communities, not just as individuals, and not just as our masajid and our institutions and our schools, but all of the institutions that have been built up in the US over the years and in Canada, that we're coming together and we're collaborating. That we're not developing our institutions in silos. We're not reinventing the wheel. A lot of the masajids here in the U.S. are very young, 10, 20, 30, 40 years maybe, at most 50 or 60. I actually met the imam, and it was a blessed opportunity for me to meet the imam who took over the masjid of Malcolm X at Hajj Malik al-Shabazz. And he told me, he said, we just celebrated our 50th anniversary as a jama'ah. 50 years, half of a century. Which masjid can claim that glory in America? But there it is, in New York. The mosque established by Malcolm X. What can we learn from their experience? Our masajid reaching out to them and saying, you are our elders. Half of a century of practicing and fulfilling Islam in this country. What are you doing? What works? What doesn't work? And there are a number of collaborations that are happening in the US. But what are we doing here in our home area of the Bay Area? As masajid collaborating together. Is there communication between the masajid? I'll just give you two simple examples of how lack of collaboration can affect our communities financially. One of the things that we have as a pillar of our faith is zakat, giving of zakat. So all of the masajid are collecting zakat. But what prevents a person from manipulating the system and going from this masjid to that masjid to this masjid to that masjid and putting in the same application everywhere? Is there connection between them? Is there a unified system to where everybody taps in and we can see where is our zakat as a community? Because zakat, we're not getting it as MCC or as Society of East Bay or of Service or as MCA. We're giving it as Muslims as part of the Ummah. This is part of our collective Baytul Mal, Muslim treasury that we all have a right to if the proper means are followed. But are we communicating? Or if there is a theft from a masjid, as has happened with two masajid, and alhamdulillah, there was communication between those masajid, and they caught the person that was coming in to steal from the sadaqah box, because that happens. The reality is that happens. There are Muslims who will steal from the charity box. So are we communicating? Are we collaborating? And that's just on a simple level. On the educational level, are we working in our Sunday schools and our Islamic schools and our after-school programs? Are we communicating and collaborating between our masajid to see what's working for you, what's not working for you? Our youth programs. We have to move away from this working in silos and reinventing the wheels towards collaboration. This is the part of coming together and holding fast to the Book of Allah. Holding fast to the Book of Allah and sharing. And reaching out to that divine assistance that Allah has promised us through His messengers on the blessed lips of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said, "Yadullahi ma'al jama'ah," the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the jama'ah.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa man wala, amma ba'd. فيا عباد الله أوصيكم وأوصي نفسي بتقوى الله. اتقوا الله في السر والعلانية, اتقوا الله ظاهرا وباطنا, اتقوا الله ويعلمكم الله. We praise Allah and we send peace and blessings upon His noble and final and most complete and most blessed messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And I advise you, dear believers, and I advise myself to have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fulfilling the commands outwardly and inwardly and avoiding the prohibitions outwardly and inwardly. I'll end with some practical advice that I begin with myself. Before we begin this work towards collaborations, and it's not something new. Houston, if you look at Houston, many of the masajid are under one umbrella organizations. Calgary has been doing this for decades. We're just now starting it in the Bay Area. So what I encourage you is that this organization that has started, Islamic Council of Northern California, reach out to us. Encourage the masajid. There are over 70 places of prayer, 70 musallas in the Bay Area. 70. Starting from the North Bay all the way down to Gilroy. 70 places, alhamdulillah. We're growing, mashallah. Just 10 or 15 years ago, it was only about 40. 30 years ago, some of you who have been in the Bay Area for 30 or 40 years, you remember when it was only one or two or three. So alhamdulillah, we've seen this development grow. And maybe part of the development had to be that we were all working within our own communities as a survival mode. But now that we're established as a greater Bay Area Muslim community, we have to collaborate. We have to come together. We have to pool resources. We have to communicate. So I encourage anybody who has a connection to any type of institution, reach out to this new council. If you are an individual as part of a community, encourage your community to reach out to this new council so that we can begin this process of collaboration. But to make that collaboration really successful, we have to start with ourselves and we have to start with our families. Allah tells us the order of priorities in the Quran. قُلْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِكُمْ نَارًا. Take care of yourselves and your family. Save yourselves and your family from the fire. So before we even think about collaborating with the greater communities, we have to make sure, am I holding fast to the Book of Allah? Am I holding fast to the rope of Allah? Because we know that feeling when we trip and when we make a mistake, whether it's a big mistake or a little mistake, whether it's a sin or not, but we know it's a mistake, we trip and we fall. We trip and we fall. When Adam alayhi salam ate from the tree, and his wife ate from the tree as well. They both ate from the tree. It's not that one tricked the other. They both ate from the tree. فَأَزَلَّهُمَا. Allah says that the shaytan made them slip. Made them trip. They slipped. And so when we trip, when we fall, when we make a mistake, we have to hold on to something. We have to hold on to some railing. We have to hold on to a rope. Our rope is the Quran. In our own personal lives, when we start feeling that we're faltering, that we're falling down, are we reaching out with all of our strengths to the Quran and looking for guidance properly? Not just opening it and hoping that we'll get some sort of inspiration. That can happen, but by properly understanding the Quran, starting with ourselves. And then moving to our families, do we really reflect the Quranic method of life and character and belief? Are we doing that in our families with our children? Are we speaking with our children the way the Quran wants us, the way Allah wants us to, through His directions in the Quran?
Are we speaking with our spouse that way? Are we speaking with our parents? Are we interacting with them based on the Quran? Because if there's no holding on to the book of Allah with ourselves, and we're not holding together as a family, then how are we going to build a community? We can have as many collaborations as we want. We can have as many organizations and conventions and so forth. But if we don't start at home, it won't work. There's a colloquial saying in Jordan that the son of the cobbler is barefoot. Ibn Skafi Hafi. In English, they say the cobbler's son has no shoes. And so if we work on fixing other people's shoes and making sure that our community, everybody has shoes, but our children at home are barefoot, our parents are barefoot, our siblings are barefoot, then what's the point, really? We're building a house, we're building a community, but our houses are empty. So I enjoin you and I enjoin myself to begin with ourselves and to begin with our families, and then from there we can build the community that will give us this assistance from Allah, that will give us this collaboration and this protection, that when the Islamophobes hurl their insults at us, when they try to bring new legislation, we will be able to respond as a Muslim community, linking with the outside communities as well, and then we can respond. And that's happening, brothers and sisters. I am actually seeing more positive things that are coming out, hearing stories from around the U.S. There's more positive than the negative that's coming out of this. It's just after 9/11, when that tidal wave of Islamophobia really took off, that had been prepared. How many people learned about Islam through that time? How many people came to the support of the Muslims? How many people became Muslim, embraced Islam as a way of life? The same thing is happening now. The only difference is now that they've had 15 years of fueling this Islamophobia industry with billions of dollars. So now when it hits the scene, it's a powerful force that's seeping down into the media, into the cartoons, into the late night shows, into our schools and the curriculum. At every level it's there, so we have to be prepared. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the strength as a community to hold fast to the book of Allah and to hold fast to the rope of Allah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us full and complete and proper understanding of His book so that we can implement it in our lives individually and as families and as communities and globally as a complete way of life. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُسْلِمَاتِ وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ